What I hope to do in this video is hopefully give you some clarity on terms that you might hear used in a fairly related way, and those are the terms gene and allele. Gene versus allele. So let's do a little bit of review. Let's just reorient ourselves in the world of DNA and RNA. Let's say that this yellow squiggly line is a length of I don't know, say my DNA. And let's say this little white section right over here, that's if we were to zoom in. And we've represented the various base pairs. And the sequence of base pairs is really the information content in DNA. And here I've just kind of drawn it as a ladder. But we know that the real structure of DNA is kind of this twisted ladder, this double helix. Now, if we talk about this whole yellow squiggly line, and it could be even a section of a longer yellow squiggly line, this could code for multiple things, especially multiple proteins. So different regions of this could code for different proteins. So for example, this section right over here could be part of this region that I'm highlighting in blue that codes for a specific protein. And so we would call this a gene. We would call this a gene. This might be a protein that is involved in, I don't know, I'll make something up. It's a protein that's involved in the immune system. Maybe this stretch, let me do it in a different color. Maybe this stretch of DNA right over here, this stretch of DNA, maybe it's a longer stretch of DNA. Maybe it codes for a protein that's used, maybe it's a protein that helps regulate DNA replication. Maybe over here is another, we encode for another protein that maybe it in some ways affects the pigmentation of your skin or the pigmentation of your eyes. And so you have these stretches of DNA that code for specific things. And actually, it doesn't have to just even be for a protein. We've always talked about, even if you do code for a protein, you go from the DNA to messenger RNA. To messenger RNA, and actually you can even go to pre-messenger RNA, and that gets processed, so you could lose some sections of it. But you go to messenger RNA, and then that messenger RNA, every three of these base pairs is a codon. So let's say that's one codon, 1, 2, 3. That's another codon, 1, 2, 3. Each of those, and maybe I'll draw them next to each other, each of them codes for an amino acid that is kind of connected together to form a protein. So that's one amino acid right over there. This could be another amino acid right over there. And obviously we can keep going on and on and on. You could have another amino acid right over here. And then they all bond to each other, and they're brought actually to the mRNA by a functional RNA group. And so there are functional things other than proteins that this could code for, like tRNA. tRNA, which is really helping to transport the appropriate amino acids to the mRNA in the ribosome so that you can construct these proteins. So you could have tRNA, and we've seen this before in previous videos, this little squiggly line matches up to the appropriate codon and then puts that amino acid in place. You also have things like ribosomal RNA that make up the structure of the actual ribosome. So RNA doesn't only have to play this kind of in-between messenger function, it actually can play a functional or a structural role. And in fact, there are theories that the earliest life, the most primitive life, was nothing but self-replicating RNA, and then the systems became more and more and more complicated and more complex, and until eventually you end up with things like redwood trees and elephants, whatever else. But it all started with potentially self-replicating RNA. Some people say it might be some type of proteins that were able to replicate. Who knows? But RNA is definitely an interesting character in this. So you go from gene to RNA, that's transcription, and then RNA to protein, that is translation. But sometimes you just stop at the RNA, and the RNA by itself plays a function. That's functional RNA. So each of these genes, they can code for a type of protein or even a functional RNA. That's what a gene is. Now what about an allele? Well, an allele is a specific variation of the gene. So for example, let's say that you look at the same stretch of DNA. Let's say this is my DNA, and if I were to take your DNA out, and if I were to look on the same chromosome at the same region, we're both human beings, and we have, for the most part, very similar DNA. So this is Actually, let me straighten it out. So let's say this is my DNA, a section of my DNA, and let's say this right over here, this in white is a section of your DNA. And so if we look at that gene, that blue gene, that's that on my DNA. Now if we look at that, and this is the blue gene on your DNA. Now we're both human beings and most of our genetic material is fairly similar, but we might have variations in how this gene is coded. For example, you might have, or I might have a, let's say I have an adenine right there, but right at that exact spot, you might have a different base. You might have a, I don't know, you might have a thymine right over there. So it's encoding for a protein or even a functional RNA that's playing the same role. Maybe it has a role in the immune system, a role in your skin color, a role in how your brain develops. But there is a variation. There's a variation in how it's coded. Now some of these variations, which could arise through mutations, it might not have any impact in the function of the eventual protein that gets constructed. You might just have a different amino acid someplace. In fact, you might not even have a different amino acid because many times you have two codons coding for the same amino acid. But even in a case, you might have one different amino acid in a protein that has 4,000 amino acids, and it doesn't change how that protein acts or how it functions. Or sometimes it might. It might change how that protein functions. It might change how that protein regulates other things and whoever knows whatever else. And so you can imagine that you have genes, this gene right over here, maybe it has a role in eye color. And because of this variation or because of other variations that show up, in both cases they code for the protein that, say, regulates eye color or regulates the amount of pigment you have. But because your variation right over here might lead or help lead, and these things are very complex. It's very seldom that you just have a gene for this. But this might make you, especially if you have a gene like this from both of your parents, maybe this one would go for blue eyes. Blue eyes. It somehow helps produce blue eyes, while mine somehow helps produce brown eyes. And obviously I'd want to think about the variant of this gene that I get from my mother and the variant of this gene that I get from my father. We all have two copies in our regular somatic cells, in our body cells. We have, except for if we think about the XX and the XY chromosomes, the sex determining chromosomes, on all of the other chromosomes, we have two copies of the same genes. We just have two. It's just they're different variants. One variant from your mother, one variant from your father. Or you could say that they are different alleles. So alleles are just different variants. So these are two different alleles. They're the same gene. They're the gene that somehow deals with eye color, but they're different variations for that gene. So the gene, you're speaking generally to that region of DNA, that region of the DNA strand that codes for some functional molecule, usually protein, but it could be RNA, while the allele is that specific variation, that flavor of that gene. Hopefully that helps.